Now to the political implications of this scandal. We're joined by CNN political commentator and former Republican Congressman Charlie Dent. So, Charlie, here we are. What do you think of all these Matt Gaetz allegations?
Wow. All I can say is that, you know, he's going to come under tremendous pressure to resign. And I served as chair of the House Ethics Committee, and I can tell you when these kinds of scandals erupt, they just snowball. And he is going to face an avalanche of pressure. This is a guy who called on Liz Cheney to be removed from her leadership position for voting for impeachment, who has, you know, very few friends in the House. And those are just Republicans. I mean, this guy has problems all over the place. His bigger problem, frankly, is with the DOJ and the sex trafficking, you know, fake IDs, cash payments, revealing about drugs. I mean, there's a whole host of things here. You know, he's lucky John Boehner right now isn't speaker or leader, because I guarantee you, he would have been summoned to the office and said, are these allegations true? If so, sign the letter on the desk. That's your resignation. Time to leave. And I was around for a lot of these types of situations. Believe me, that's where this is heading.
Speaking of John Boehner, this morning, an excerpt from his upcoming book was published in Politico, where he really dealt with the rise of these folks like Matt Gaetz. These folks were performative rather than trying to get something done. Here's what he wrote in part. These guys wanted 100% every time. In fact, I don't think even that would have satisfied them, because they didn't really want legislative victories. They wanted wedge issues and conspiracies and crusades. A lot of them wanted to blow up Washington. That's why they thought they were elected. I know this resonates with you. This is part of the fights that you've been having with your party. But Matt Gaetz is sort of exhibit A, someone who thought that being a member of Congress was about trolling, not actually solving problems for the people.
Well, you know what, John? You know, Matt Gaetz is the latest in a very long list, a long band of a merry band of destroyers, you know, who would come to Washington to blow things up, just as Boehner said. They, you know, they saw any type of compromise, any type of accommodation as surrender, as capitulation, as a betrayal. I mean, this is, and when Boehner talks about this, he knows. He was a speaker. He's a Republican majority in the House, a Democratic Senate, a Democratic president. We had to make agreements. And these people turned on him and people like me and threw us under the bus at every opportunity to advance themselves. And one of the reasons I became outspoken as a member, I was one of those guys who had my head down for most of my time. They're just trying to do my job. But when I saw some of these more exotic members, what I would often refer to as the wackadoodles, going out on television, defining all of us, I felt it was important for folks like me to stand up and say something. In fact, the leaders, Boehner and others, encouraged me to get up and speak, not just in the Republican conference, but publicly, because they needed support. Because these other guys are going on another network and making a lot of noise, and life hell for everyone.
Well, I mean, that other network has aided and abetted the wackadoodle contingent, as you say. And John Boehner writes about that in his book. He says, besides the homegrown talent at Fox with their choice of guests, they were making people who used to be fringe characters into powerful media stars. One of the first prototypes of their laboratory was a woman named Michelle Bachmann. There's a direct line from Michelle Bachmann through Donald Trump to Matt Gaetz.
Exactly. And of course, you know, that was one of the reasons why I became outspoken. I was so tired of being defined by that. You know, people were trying to suggest that I was somehow was in agreement with her statements that were very conspiratorial and wacky. And I was in those meetings, too, when, you know, she wanted the seat on the Ways and Means Committee and all the rest of us who are doing our job saying, are you serious? That's for people who actually are serious about their jobs and working. And you know, so there were a lot of us who pushed back. I mean, we even had situations where I'd sit in meetings with John Boehner and we talked about, you know, you didn't want to put some Freedom Caucus people in subcommittee chairs. And one of the committee chairs said, well, I have too many on my committee. He was the land of misfit toys. I mean, he had to appoint some of them to subcommittees. But we were trying to find ways not to elevate those types of people who really had no interest in governing, but just were trying to blow things up every day.
Well, at least Marjorie Taylor Greene is in Matt Gaetz's
corner. Don't forget Jim Jordan.
Yeah. Charlie, thank you. Great to talk to you.
Thanks
for reminding us of how we got here.
Dan and Emily just mentioned the buffoon wing of the Republican Party, which frankly has been fairly bulletproof in recent years, at least when it comes to the base. But we have an extraordinary new excerpt from John Boehner's upcoming book published in Politico, in which he really addresses how this problem in the Republican Party predates President Trump. And I want to read you just one excerpt that gets to the heart of the power of the buffoon wing. He says, these guys wanted 100% every time. In fact, I don't think that would satisfy them because they don't really want legislative victories. They wanted wedge issues and conspiracies and crusades. A lot of them just wanted to blow up Washington. That's why they thought they were elected. Obviously, that's a huge condemnation from a former Speaker of the House to the base of his political party that has led to people like Matt Gaetz. What's your take?
That's exactly right. I mean, he is talking about what happened when he became Speaker with the help of the Tea Party. And he talks in that extraordinary excerpt. You're exactly right. I mean, this book is going to be remarkable. He talked about the fact that so many people who were elected didn't understand how Washington and legislating worked, didn't care when he talked to them. He said it went in one ear, out the other. And it is so apt and so timely, given the fact that it has only gotten worse, only gotten more intense, and that dynamic has become so consuming of the Republican Party. And when I say that dynamic, it is playing to not just the cameras, but playing to the conservative base and conservative media. And bringing it back to where we started the conversation, Matt Gaetz is, at this point, Exhibit A of that kind of person. As you use the word buffoonery. I mean, I think John Boehner uses words that are even more
anatomical,
illustrative of what he's trying to put across. And that's what I'm hearing from people about Matt Gaetz, that they feel that these are Republicans, that he just wants to be on TV. He wants to be a conservative media darling, and he doesn't have a huge appetite for legislating.
Yes, and that you need a conduit to the cameras. And John Boehner, in his book, Niamalika, talks about the Fox News Channel and how he watched it get more extreme and fringy and conspiratorial and paranoid. I mean, he just lays it right out about how Roger Ailes was just becoming more paranoid after 2008, and how Fox, he talks about the homegrown talent and what they were doing at FNC. Besides the homegrown talent at Fox, with their choice of guests, they were making people who used to be fringe characters into powerful media stars. One of the first prototypes out of their laboratory was a woman named Michelle Bachmann.
And the biggest media star out of Fox News was Donald Trump. Remember, right? Mm-hmm. He was the one who was going on Fox News early on to test drive some of his messaging, but to also to borrow from Fox News. You know, we kind of think of Donald Trump as a sui generis figure, as somebody who kind of felt where the base was. He was really, you know, kind of borrowing what he was hearing on Fox News and knew that that resonated given the kind of ratings that Fox News was able to amass among a certain segment of the population. So we talk, you know, about Matt Gaetz, we talk about Michelle Bachmann, but Donald Trump is right in league with those folks, a conspiracy theorist, was a fringe political figure for many years before he ran for president in 2016 and obviously won. So, you know, I think Fox News brought us sort of the apex of the buffoon wing of the Republican Party in Donald Trump. He was sort of the head of that, and now you have the Republican Party dealing with that identity crisis. Who are they? Are they the party of Matt Gaetz? Are they still the party of Donald Trump? It certainly seems like, and it certainly seems like a lot of the folks in the Republican Party still very much beholden to Fox News, not as interested in legislating, much more interested in conspiracy theories and wedge issues.
Well, on this Holy Week and Passover, perhaps a biblical phrase applies, you reap what you sow. Congressman Charlie Dent's going to join us to talk about this more in the next hour. Thank you very much, guys. It's great to see you.